Honey is a huge favorite of mine, and it didn't used to be until I learned about it. It just, it's not something that's in the mainstream media. You're not really going to hear a lot about honey, but honey is phenomenal. And so I found out that my friends, Mike and Leah, are beekeepers, and Mike is actually doing some extracting tonight, and I actually scored by them giving me a call and letting me know that they're doing that. So I'm going to go in, do some filming, and watch how they do it, and then I'm gonna be able to score myself some free honey on the way out, if all goes well. So, wish me luck.
So the honey that we're gonna bring out and do today is a late summer honey.
Okay.
It's probably the latest honey that most beekeepers will pull.
Right.
That any beekeepers will pull.
Right.
I'm a little nuts that way, I'll go for this stuff. It's related to buckwheat. So the stuff you're gonna see tonight, it's dark, some of it will look like coffee
right.
in color.
Yeah, that's cool.
Nutty, woody flavor to it.
What's it called?
It's called Japanese knotweed. It's an invasive plant to BC
right.
that puts off this honey. It's a relative of buckwheat. It's like molasses.
It totally tastes like molasses.
Yeah.
That's not bad. The bees store honey in the cells and cap it with a wax capping that is made by the female worker bees. The vibrating knife from this machine is filled with warm water, and as it shaves off the caps to expose the wax with some of the honey falls into a spinning centrifuge, which separates them. The honey flows back into the sump with the rest of the honey, and the wax stays inside to be scooped out at the end of the day.
And this is what people also make candles out of?
Yes. Yeah. After early August,
yeah,
it's kind of a good idea to let the bees have whatever they collect. It gives them a little bit of natural feed.
Yeah.
I found that with this particular honey, though, I tend to find that if I do leave this for the bees,
yeah,
it tends to be in the hive in the spring.
Really?
It doesn't. They collect it. They yeah. store it. It doesn't seem to be one of their favorites to feed off of.
No way.
Yeah, I'm not sure why.
But they still survive. They eat enough to stay alive.
Yeah.
So once you've uncapped, which means taking all the wax off the top, you have to spin it to get the honey out.
That's right.
Give it a little kick, pull it down, and let it go.
Does that honey coming out there right now, does that still have to be cleaned? Like, does it still have to go through something?
Yeah. We'll let it settle. Anything that doesn't belong in the honey will either sink or float.
Right.
The wax, the bees that make it in there, things like that,
yeah.
we can skim them off. And then from there, we'll pour it through the screen sieve with a cloth in it.
Yeah.
It's a fine mesh cloth to get everything else out that we don't want to see in our jar of honey.
This honey would be like a delicacy.
If you wanted buckwheat honey,
yeah.
you have to buy buckwheat honey produced in Manitoba. They don't produce it anywhere near.
Oh.
So
this is our local honey here. How often do these wooden frames get reused?
As long as they last. We throw that back in, the bees will clean that back up.
Yeah.
They'll make it look perfect again and they'll refill it.
This is just how you buy it in the store. They build all these hexagon shapes.
So the bees actually do that?
Yeah. They produce the wax and they build all the cells and then they store the honey in and then they cap it off.
How many times have you guys been stung?
I get stung countless times each day.
Probably 3-4 dozen times a day.
Okay, what did he just say?
3-4 dozen times a day. Your immune system becomes accepting to it after time. But the most common reason that they sting us is while we're working with them, we inadvertently pinch or kill one.
Oh.
And when we do that, it releases a pheromone
yeah.
that triggers other bees, like say Africanized bees, where they react more aggressively towards the pheromone.
So if one of them gets hurt, they go in attack mode
that's
for probably
generally,
everything
generally
that's around,
how they do it.
Right?
Anything that's around, they just go nuts for it.
It was at this point that I realized being a beekeeper was not in my future.
Once you've been marked with the pheromone, which usually occurs when you kill a bee,
yeah.
the pheromone, you know, you get it on you when you kill that bee.
Right.
You're tagged. It's their way to deal with things like bears. A bear
yeah.
gets stung in the nose,
yeah.
more bees go for the nose.
For the nose.
And eventually the bear's going to give up. It's got a thick hide.
Yeah.
But one bee found its way through, and that's how he tags. On a day like today, it's too cool for forage flights to go on, so all the bees are home. And when you open the hive,
yeah.
the old nasty bees, that they must be grumpy with life, they're home. And they're not happy to see you.
Oh.
So they're usually the ones that when you open the lid, they go straight for your face. So scout bees go up first. And they base their search on the area they found food the first day.
Right.
So they found food in that area yesterday.
They're going to go back for sure.
They're going to go back there today.
Yeah.
They're going to come back with a sample. They're going to dance around and tell the other bees, I found honey.
Yeah.
It's this far away in this direction.
Yeah.
And then they give up a taste of it and they say, this is what it tastes like. So those other bees carry on.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Here's kind of a honey fun fact. Honey isn't always flavored by artificial ingredients. Natural honey flavors are usually created when the scout bee goes out, finds the food source from a nearby flowering bush or plant, and comes back to the hives and relays the message to the rest of the bees. The rest of the bees then go out to that same area and create that particular flavor of honey, whether it be from the blackberry bushes or the clover fields. That's how we get all those different flavors of honey. Can I try?
It just went in her hair.
Did it? Oh no!
It did too. Yeah.
It did.
Is it okay to not pasteurize the honey?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because
as adults with a developed immune system, there's nothing in here that's going to harm us.
That's what I thought.
And anything that's in there is edible. It's sterilized by the honey.
Yeah.
The high sugar content of the honey and the enzymes in it sterilize it. A compromised or underdeveloped immune system, if there was a botulism spore to be present in that honey,
yeah,
and it got into your gut, it could do damage.
Right.
Yeah. Right. But for the for anybody over two and up to the frail elderly,
yeah,
you know, you're fine. Your immune system's going to take care of it.
Now, this was really important to me. This was Mike's response when I asked him about the effects of pasteurization on the honey itself.
You're knocking off all the enzymes and things that are good that are in honey. You're essentially turning it, in my opinion, into a flavored sugar syrup.
Yeah, right.
You know, it's not being processed, but it's being sterilized. Globalization, moving the bees around, we've been introduced to pests and pathogens that shouldn't be in North America, but we've brought them in through globalization. With, you know, with the need to pollinate crops and keep our populations up, we move bees all over the world. And in doing that, we move diseases all over the world. We're scrambling to find populations of bees wherever we can get them from.
Wow.
You know, it's a scramble, and it's how the industry is.
Yeah, so it's not easy.
It's not easy, but it's fun. You know, and it's necessary. They can't keep themselves anymore.
Yeah.
We built an environment for them that would wipe them out if we let them go on their own. They need us to help them, or they're not going to make it.
And if there's no bees, there's no...
There's no bees, there's no agriculture. If you take the bee away, which is the catalyst for the food development,
yeah,
you know, we cut back on crops,
yeah,
right?
So like we always said, support your local farmer. Helping out a friend, their honey stand. I'm getting paid in honey. And of course, everyone's very happy to get free samples too, so this is a good thing. We got a clover one here.
Yeah.
And we'll do a cranberry one here. Valley Gold Honeybee, the store. This is what I got. This is what I got for my work.